Let's stand together and praise the Lord. Oh, come to the altar. of the announcements, let's go to the Lord in a word of opening prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before you now. We're so grateful that you have invited us to enter into your gates with thanksgiving. As we come before you, as we come to the altar this morning, we do so after, you know, a long period of not being able to, for health and safety reasons, to meet in this way. And we know that there's nothing special about this sanctuary, that this building is not any more sacred or less sacred than our own living room or bedroom. But we recognize that this is a special moment for us to corporately gather together again with our brothers and our sisters and lift up your name in worship. And so as we reflect on this special moment, as we accept this invitation to come to the altar, may our hearts overflow with thanksgiving and praise, as commanded by or as spoken of by the psalmist in Psalm 100 that we read earlier. And may our praises go before you as a sweet-smelling sacrifice. Father, we lift up the names of individuals who are going through difficult times with health. We think of Robert, we think of Janet, we pray for them. We think of Mr. and Mrs. Kelly. We're grateful for their being home. We just pray for their continued recovery as well. We pray that you would draw near to everyone who is suffering any kind of physical ailment, whether it be related to the coronavirus or other things, that as they go through the challenges that they have with their health, that they would feel your presence with them. We know that in this life, Father, we will face challenges and trials and difficulties. We're so grateful that you've promised to be with us through everything, and that we are not alone. Father God, as we continue before you now in praise and worship, we just pray that you would be with us. We pray for your blessing upon this time. May we sense your spirit moving amongst us and a deep sense of communion with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This next song, if you're able to stand and be socially distant, it might be a good idea to do so. We're going to sing about our Waymaker. Thank you. Waymaker.
Well, hello, church. Am I on? Can you hear me? Taking my mask off. Hopefully, I don't scare you.
Am I on?
I is on. Praise the Lord. He is worthy to be praised.
Amen. The house of the Lord say so. Firstly, I do want to say it is a, you know, it's a strange and interesting time. And I have to say I am thankful to Macomb and to Bethany, who did a stellar job with recording and posting it, and I know it was a lot of work. And so, there is also another thing that nothing new is under the sun, but our sovereign God is in control and will be always. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for your love, for your presence in our lives, the fact that you are sovereign, the fact that you are in control. Lord, there are so many blessings that we have, even in the midst of what we think are difficult times. Let us never forget. Let us always praise you and glorify you. Lord, there is a purpose in everything that happens. And that purpose is to bring you glory and praise. And I pray that we do that in our lives, the difficult times and easy times. Lord, as we come here now, we ask that you would indeed be glorified, that those people, even though that they may not be with us now, are one in spirit, one in truth, one in worship to you. And Lord, now we ask that may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing in your sight. O Lord, our rock and our redeemer, it is in the precious name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Firstly, just a quick update. I will be sending more information around, but with regard to our brother Robert, he is in critical condition, but he is somewhat improving. And so we never take anything for granted. A concern that Nanlin has shared is that his kidneys continue to function. She has not been able to be with him since Wednesday. And so I know that that's a great concern for her, but she understands the necessity and the reason behind that. But we do ask that his body continue, like they've reduced some of the medications, reduce some of the things that need to be done, but it is an improvement, and we give all glory to God. But she does appreciate our prayers indeed. So we've been going through the seven I Am's statements that Jesus made. And last week, as you may recall, we were looking at the death, the illness and the death of Lazarus. And that, you know, that passage began with some distressing news. The sisters came and they expressed to Jesus or sent news to Jesus that Lazarus was ill. And in fact, he ended up dying. And we began, like we went into the passage where Jesus did what? He started comforting the sisters. So when there's distressing news, when there's distressing times, Jesus comes and he comforts us. And he says to Martha, he says, "No, Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die, and whoever lives by believing in me will never die." Let me rephrase that again, or read that properly again. I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes me will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe? And what does he do after that? He goes and he miraculously raises Lazarus from the dead, proving that he is who he says he is. Because he did what? He had power over death. Let's not miss that. He has power over death. Similarly, this week, we begin today's passage with some distressing news. The disciples have been given some news from Christ that he is going to be leaving them. In verse 33, he says, "My children, I will be with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and just as I told the Jews, so I tell you now, where I am going, you cannot come." This, for the disciples, was very distressing. The same Jesus that they had been with for 3 years, the same Jesus where they even saw Jesus raise Lazarus from the dead, they believed in him as the Lord, a wonderful teacher. He was going to leave them. Very distressing indeed. But we begin this section where the title is Jesus Comforts His Disciples. We're going to be looking at John chapter 14, and I will be reading verse 1 through 7. "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." The word of the Lord is proclaimed. Thanks be to God. Comfort. You know, troubled people in troubled times need peace and affirmation. They need comfort. This is a passage of comfort. You may have heard it many times recited at funerals. Why? Well, because there is a truth in what Jesus says, that if he is going ahead and he is going to heaven to be with the Father, he is preparing room for you where you may be also. For all those who believe, for his disciples, just as he was talking to his disciples, he says it to his disciples today. There is a place for you in heaven, and I needed to go there and prepare it for you. We also know that in him going there, he has given us the Holy Spirit. And so when he gives us this life, he's also given us the life of the Holy Spirit that dwells within you and I, for all those who would receive the gift. But I don't want you to miss this. The troubles of these disciples, we may quickly read over it. It was distressing. It was real discomfort and distressing news. Just as real as all the distressing news that we may have. And have any of us had distressing news? Please don't answer. I don't want your aerosols in here. But this is disturbing news. I like what the second verse says here, because the antidote, the solution for distress, is trust. To trust in God. And he says, "I know you trust in God, but trust in me also." We need to trust despite the circumstances, despite what we face. We need to trust in the love, the presence, the power of Jesus Christ. Because it is the truth. The good news. Well, the good news is what Jesus says here. The way. He is the way. reconciliation. He is the truth. There is illumination. And there is the life. There is regeneration. The way. Well, this is the truth. All have sinned. Has any one of you not sinned? Put up your hand. Thank you. No hands went up. We have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. This is another truth. The wages of sin is death. Eternal death. You know, for those who sin, you are going to receive eternal damnation unless you receive the gift that Jesus Christ gives you. The gift of God is eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:18 and 19 says this, God who reconciled us to Himself through Christ. And He gave us the ministry of reconciliation that what? God was reconciling the world to Himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them. Hallelujah, amen. Because I'm a sinner. And this is wonderful, glorious, comforting news. Jesus is the way. We talked about it even as we looked at the gate and the shepherd. You go through Christ, you go through the gate, you go through the shepherd in order to get into His flock. This is another way of saying the same thing. Truth. There is illumination. Well, have you not heard that all truth is relative? What is this world giving us? This world is redefining what truth is. Isaiah 50, 20 and 21 says this, and you know, are we in these times? Again, nothing new under the sun. Woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Woe to those who are wise in their own eyes and clever in their own sight. The world, even the churches, are redefining what truth is. It should not be so. There is indeed a father of lies. You belong to your father, John 8:44. You belong to your father, the devil, and you who want to carry out your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning, not holding to the truth, for there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father of lies. You know, how many things do we look at in life and say, well, it's okay to do that. I don't have to wait till marriage. Like, I'm not going to die if I do this. It's okay to just help myself to that. No. There is an absolute truth. We find it in God's Word. The boundaries cannot be moved. There was a garden called the Garden of Eden. And what did the serpent say? Surely God didn't say that. Surely you won't die. Never look back. There is absolute truth. Ephesians 4, 4 to 6 says this, there is one body and one spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. John 1:17, for the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. John 1:14, the Word became flesh and dwell amongst us. We have seen His glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. John 5:33, when they were trying to get testimony out of Christ, Jesus said, "You have sent these people, you have sent to John, John the Baptist, and he says, he has testified to the truth." John the Baptist's testimony was about Christ, the truth. And finally, here is a true statement. Acts 4:12. Salvation is found in no one else. Going back to the first one, no way. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved.
Amen.
This is truth. And then the life. Life is Christ's gift. It's a gift. It's a precious gift that he has given to you and I. But not only is that so, that life is Christ himself. I am the way, the truth, the life. And of course, we saw this last week in his statement, "I am the resurrection and the life." Do you believe? We know John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whomsoever believeth in him should not die, but have eternal life." Jesus Christ. And we know the song, "Because he lives, I can face tomorrow." If Christ didn't live, if Christ didn't rise from the dead, you and I are hopeless. 1 Corinthians 15, 7-20 says this, "And if Christ has not been raised, your faith, my faith, our faith is futile, because you are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost as well." All those loved ones that we have. If only for this life we have hope in Christ. If only for this life. If our rejoicing is only because of Jesus in this life, when we die, we're done. We are all, of all people, to be pitied. No, but Christ has indeed been raised from the dead. You know, I missed the Easter sunrise service. We had a wonderful sunrise service last Sunday. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first of those who have fallen asleep. Do you believe this? Do you believe this?
Amen.
It's essential.
Amen.
And then lastly, and I'll try and make this quick, because we're trying to keep together in reasonable time here. The exclusivity of Jesus Christ. And it's offensive. Have you ever heard of Michael Ramsden came down, and one of the questions he had, that was from Ravi Zechariah International Ministries, and he put on a talk, and the question was, is Christianity offensive? And the answer is, yes, it is offensive. But this is why. If you have another belief, whatever it may be, and you are told what Jesus says, "No man comes to the Father except through me," you have offended them. And it's not I offending, it is Jesus Christ's word himself that offends. It's a hard statement. It's hard to be received. We love people, and we're to embrace people. We're to be gracious and loving. But we can't compromise the truth. This exclusivity, though, is for all people. Christ died for everyone. And all have an opportunity to believe, to call upon him. But there is one way. One and only one. And that is the truth. Christ alone.
I am
the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody comes to the Father except through me. Christ alone. Do you believe? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the truth in your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you that he is the way. Thank you that he is the truth. Thank you that he is life. And for all who call upon him, who all who believe, we receive. And we are so thankful. Lord, be glorified, even in the midst of what we face. Help us to hold on to this truth and be comforted, because your words are comforting. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, church. I just want to encourage you now to him who is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, both now and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace.